I won't back down. No, I won't back down. You can stand me up at the gates of hell, but I won't back down. Gonna stand my ground, won't be turned around. And I'll keep this world from dragging me down. Gonna stand my ground, and I won't back down. Hey, baby, there ain't no easy way out. Hey, I will stand my ground, and I won't back down. Well, I know what's right. I got just one life. In a world that keeps on pushing me around, but I stand my ground, and I won't back down. Hey, baby, there ain't no easy way out. Hey, I will stand my ground, and I won't back down. No, I won't back down.
Well, hi everyone. Great that you're here. Thank you so much. Was just a little introduction of Tony Bennett and his association with the McCanns, just to give some of you a little idea, but we've got lots more. And I'm so happy and excited to have him here today. So what we will do is, first of all, welcome you all. I really, really appreciate all the mods and everybody here right now. So thanks very much. And also to Kim and Chris. We never forget Kim and Chris. Now, I've known Tony for quite some time during the Madeleine McCann case. He's one of the greatest researchers that there is on the case. And he has put himself right up front and a target by the McCanns, as you can see, apart from having probably one of the most, the largest research file going, probably, knowing Tony, even bigger than mine, I'm sure. Now, he is a retired solicitor, and at one point he was given, he was told by the McCanns to stop talking about the case. They have interest in one man. It seems very odd, but anyway, he was the target, and they gave him six key demands that he had to adhere to. Now, these six key demands are what they asked him to permanently take down his website, Madeleine Foundation, to deliver up to Carter Ruck all outstanding copies of the booklet, What Really Happened to Madeleine McCann, 60 Reasons, which suggest that she was not abducted, to deliver up to Carter Ruck all outstanding copies of the leaflet, to erase all electronic copies of both the booklet and the leaflet, to use our best endeavors to remove all allegedly defamatory postings by either of us on any website. That was between him and the others on the Madeleine Foundation. and to permanently cease from making any further allegedly defamatory statements about the McCanns. Now, that was the requirement, but for Tony to have fought against that would have meant that, as it says here, the clear advice was given that because of the high degree of uncertainty in the libel litigation, there was no guarantee that could be given that if he defended the libel suit, that it'd win. It was emphasized in graphic terms that on a worst case scenario, the outcome could mean complete financial ruin for both Debbie at the time and Tony, with all the savings raided and court orders made to recover the equity value each of us have in the homes we own. It's a pretty devastating thing to risk. And, well, I'm going to tell you what I understand happened, but of course Tony can give you the real details, is that he was not... The McCanns had Carter Ruck, the most feared lawyers in Britain, according to the Times, but I'm sure it's true. And he knew that he couldn't risk the everything. So they chose to adhere to those six key demands. What happened was that they were following him, and they found him posting on a couple of forums and immediately took him to court for contempt. The court process was just devastating. I mean, to go, that must have been such a terrible, terrible experience for him. And I remember making a video the night before to wish him luck. And it was so distressing to realize that the following morning he could be going to prison. And I was distressed. I have no idea how Tony was feeling. It was just awful. So maybe before I go any further, I'm going to play another one of the video, because I'd really like to show a few videos so that to introduce you to Tony much better than I probably can. So let me see here. Oh, and Shirley, thank you. I haven't thanked you for being here. Dear Shirley, always here by my side.
You're welcome. Of course I'm here. I'm invested in this, getting to learning about this and getting to know the history. So of course I'm here.
Yeah, that's great. I know you really follow stuff and go off on your own and listen to podcasts, and so do a lot of other members of starting to get interested in it. And I'm really happy about that, because I think despite anything else, Madeleine's case is the biggest unsolved case of this time. You know, I not just this year, obviously it's been the last 13 years, but there is so much involved in the case, what we're supposed to believe happened and what actually likely happened is two different things. And at the cover-up, there absolutely seems to be a cover-up. Now, what's interesting is, as I was saying, Tony is absolutely one of the best researchers. And I certainly have spent a lot of time researching. Now, as most of you know, my research comes up with the conclusion based on my facts that I've put together, that something happened to Madeleine early in the week. Now, Tony and I both disagree on how we get there. It's not so much that we disagree. Tony took a different route, but how amazing. He came up with the same scenario. So that kind of tells you it doesn't matter what route you go down, you come up with the fact or the the probability, should I say, that something happened to Maddie during during the week. Now, keep in mind, because of all these court cases, Tony is not allowed to discuss some things. So he knows, I'm not sure exactly, but he knows how far he can go. I mean, if there's, he's supplied me with so many links and to pass to you. So, I mean, just this week will be really something to investigate yourself. I'm really happy about this. So let me just another video. If you can just give me a minute, I just want to make sure I've got the right one going. So okay. It just takes a few seconds for me to get to the right one. And so, hopefully this is the right one. So here we go.
Come via the internet, where thousands of people have responded to the story, and groups such as truthformadeline.com have formed. A leading member of this community is Tony Bennett, a former solicitor.
After a number of months, I was very concerned that the authorities were taking no action at all about the child neglect dossier, and I issued an application in Leicestershire Magistrates Court for a summons to be issued alleging child neglect. That was quite simply because the McCanns had openly admitted
to leaving the three young children on their own six nights in a row.
But what about Maddie's parents, who left her alone when they went to dinner the night she vanished?
The high emotions of the Madeleine McCann case, grief, hope, desperation.
The media repeatedly seemed to print all of Clarence Mitchell's statements without any kind of query. I mean, every time he opens his mouth, the media reproduces words and echo them.
Have you talked to Mr. Bennett? Why waste your breath? Mr. Bennett, if he's watching, I have to wonder what his personal motives for this are. He has a history of associating himself with high-profile cases. Kate and Jerry have committed no offence under any country's law. They accept they made a mistake that night, and they are paying the greatest price for it. To compound that agony and misery by trying to launch spurious, self-serving, publicity-seeking enterprises such as a private prosecution, which was doomed to fail from the outset, is, well, it's beyond contempt, I'm afraid.
Condemnation. Truth on my side, accusations, lies, hand me my sentence, I show no repentance, I suffer with pride, if for honesty you want apologies, I don't sympathize. Kindness you substitute. Please open your eyes.
Questions to be answered and as I say, and I've got to be careful what I say, but I do question their version of events and whether in fact Madeleine was abducted, as do many other people. Condemnation.
Try. Here on the stand with the book in my hand, truth on my side. Accusations. Lies. Hand me my sentence, I show no repentance. I suffer with pride. If for honesty you want apologies, I don't sympathize. The kindness you substitute blindness. Please open your eyes. Condemnation. Why? That was my crime. Feel elation. To know I can trust this fix of injustice time after time. If you see purity as immaturity, well, it's no surprise. If for kindness you substitute blindness, please open your eyes.
But I think the word threat is too strong.
Well, give me another word then for threat, could you?
Persuade them.
Persuasion.
Condemnation. Try. Here on the stand with the book in my hand, truth on my side. Accusations.
Thank you, sir. I would like to emphasize that I strongly believe in freedom of speech, but where you have people who are repeatedly carrying out inaccuracies and have been shown to do so, then they should be held to account. That is the issue. I don't have a problem somebody purporting a theory, writing fiction, suggestions.
Condemnation. Try. Here on the stand with the book in my hand, truth on my side. Accusations. Lies. Hand me my sentence, I'll show no repentance. I'll suffer with pride. If for honesty you want apologies, I don't sympathize.
There are always going to be those who entirely believe the McCanns account.
The little silence while I get back onto StreamYard there. Just amazing. I'm sure you agree that what Tony has been through.
Although the parents of the missing Leicestershire girl, Madeleine McCann, had started legal action.
Excuse me, I've got to.
Who they claim has breached an order not to publish allegations linking them with her disappearance.
Tony Bennett, who set up the Madeleine Foundation, has appeared at the High Court in London, where he denies a contempt of court application, which was made by the McCanns.
There, I think I've got rid of that one. They tend to start up automatically, and that wasn't what I planned. Anyway, yeah, it's just incredible what he's had to go through. I mean, nobody can say that there's anybody who's put more into this, really, honestly. And hopefully he's going to be up shortly. Yes, I believe he's there waiting. So what I'll do is introduce him right now. So welcome, Tony.
Really? Honestly, and hopefully he's going to be up shortly. Yes, I believe he's.
Okay, Tony. Can you turn the audio down?
Introduced him right now. So welcome, Tony. Really, honestly,
Tony.
Hopefully he's going to be up shortly. Yes, I believe he's.
We'll get there, Tony. I forgot to remind him to turn it off.
Introduced him right now. So welcome, Tony. Hopefully he's going to be up shortly. Yes.
Okay, Tony, can you remove?
We're okay now, are we?
Okay, yeah. I do that all the time. I'm on the YouTube page, and then I click into StreamYard and forget that the YouTube page is still running, and of course there's a delay. So anyway,
that's not my fault.
As long as we've got past that one, I think. I can hear some echo. Anyway, welcome, Tony, after that. Thank you so much for being here. I'm so excited and happy that you were able to make it.
I'm very pleased, Liz, not least because in the early days, you led the way with some fantastic research, which we all used. And I'm glad you're still here as well.
Yeah. Almost. I haven't been working too much on the Maddie case just lately, but plan to get back to it. And I really enjoy doing this every Saturday and the whole idea of all this is to get the information out to the UK and those that don't know about the case and think she was abducted.
That's important. One of the things we're exploring at the minute is how to try and get the information out in Portugal as well as England, of course. It's important that everybody knows the facts, but the people and the police who need to know are up in Portugal. And so we've got one or two initiatives going to try and get information out to the Portuguese. And I've seen it already on the YouTube channel. You've put up my little dossier about what we've been doing, but we've got these translations of Richard Hall's videos up in Portuguese now.
Oh, that's great.
And they're going okay so far. There's a few hundred views, but we need to get that out a bit more. And in fact, the next part of that plan is to try and get the email addresses of some of the journalists in Portugal and let them have a good look at those videos in Portuguese. They may never have seen the evidence that's in those films.
Yeah, well, that's exactly the point, to be able to get to everybody. Now, the reason I claim to be there to get the news or the information to the UK is mainly because I believe, and I absolutely believe, that the thing that the McCanns fear the most is that the information from the police files gets to the UK public. And I believe that's why you were targeted, because you were making a great effort to do that. And they needed to stop you. How much did the court case cost in the end?
Well, they told me that I kept getting intimidating letters telling me what their costs bill was. So as we went along, they would send me a letter saying, our costs bill is now £100,000. Our costs bill is now £150,000. It kept on climbing. It was real pressure. And so it cost them... They told me it was approximately £373,000 all their lawyers' fees, their barristers' fees, and so on.
The QC.
Well, yeah, they've got a QC as well. And it was an amount I couldn't have paid. Obviously, if I'd had to pay all their court costs, I wouldn't be living in a home anymore, in my own home anymore.
It's just absolutely, there is no word that they would do that and risk that money from, did they get it from the Search for Madeleine fund?
Well, you know.
Or would they have got it from there?
Lizzie, you probably remember this, but there's a line somewhere in the book Madeleine by Kate McCann, where she says that the Carter Ruck were giving their services for free. Do you remember that?
Very vaguely.
Yeah. They, which made me laugh, really, because they weren't they weren't giving them free, so far as I was concerned. No, there's a little line in the book which says that Carteret were being very kind and giving their services for free. Well, I don't believe that for a moment, do you? That they were just donating all this time.
Yeah, it pro bono, I think, was that the word that they may have used. Yeah,
pro bono, that's right.
Yeah, I mean, you were one of quite a few that they tried to sue. I mean, there were many. It wasn't just you. You ended up in court. We don't know a lot of what happened to some of the others. But, I mean, there's a long list of people that they sued. And that's why I say I absolutely believe their most important effort was to stop the UK from learning the truth through the Portuguese police files. They did. The newspapers did release some information, but they were quickly shut down. Maybe for a day or two, right?
You know what the problem was? The problem was the little booklet that we produced. yeah. Called it became known as 60 Reasons, and it first had its life, that book, on a forum called Truth for Madeleine, which was run by somebody called Steve Marsden in America, and he set that up sometime early in 2008, I think. Yeah, that's the one. Very good. And in August of that year, August of 2008, yes, I started writing about all the indications that this wasn't abduction. And I put them into a little article on his site called 30 Reasons Why This May Not Have Been an Abduction. And there was a big reaction to that. Lots of people contacted me after that. And so it entered my head to write a booklet. And if I may say, I was slightly emboldened in doing this because only about a year before, I'd written a book on the Stuart Lubbock death at the home of Michael Barrymore. And as you can imagine, my wife was extremely anxious that I would be sued by Michael Barrymore because I basically accused him of having killed Stuart Lubbock along with others and covered it up. But mercifully, he didn't sue me. So I kind of got emboldened and thought, well, let me have a crack at this one. And it was the little booklet, when it started selling well, that was really the downfall. It was getting into print, it was getting bought and sold, and people were reading it and passing it on, and it was they wanted to suppress the booklet above all.
Yeah, and I mean, you're well known for that. You don't sing, do you?
Well, I think so. I tell you what, I've sung that song many, many times. I really have, actually. It's okay. Almost if I lived in San Francisco, I think.
Yeah. A lot of people weren't aware of much of the Maddie case. So the title, just saying Tony Bennett, had them thinking that we had the singer on. But you're much more interesting. So I'm really pleased that you came. It's really great.
I once had a very embarrassing letter from a female, I think in America, who thought I was the real Tony Bennett. I can't repeat the things that she said in the letter, I'm afraid.
Oh, that's cute. So I don't know how you wanted to kind of get into some of the stuff. I think I actually blocked you off there when you were discussing about the book going to Portugal. Now, would you prefer to just continue as you want to continue, or do you want to go through the list? I've put the list that the little list that you gave me up, and maybe you might want to go through that.
I think possibly not. I think that list is available. It's going to be available for all your people to watch, I think.
Absolutely, yeah.
And so, you know, I'm quite happy. I don't know if you are, people have got questions, but I'd be very happy to start answering any questions people might have right away, Liz, if you want to do it that way.
Okay. Well, Shirley is here. Let me introduce you to Shirley. She is my right-hand man.
Hello, Tony. Hello. I'm American, but I wasn't the one that wrote the letter to you.
Okay. Okay. Whereabouts in America?
I'm in Alaska.
Okay. I'll tell you what, I know the map of America so well now because I've been following the American election and I know where every state is, of course. Anyway, good to talk to you.
Okay, so Shirley's in charge of checking out. I can't always see chat, and when I'm trying to concentrate on something, I'm oblivious to what's being said. So Shirley can pop up any questions. Are there any yet? Any questions yet, Shirley?
Yeah, there was one, but I just copied it because it was further up in the chat. This was from Devil's Advocate. Why did they ban the PJ files in the UK?
Right. Why didn't they ban the PJ files in the UK?
Why did they?
Oh, sorry. Why did they? Well, it's very embarrassing. The files were incredibly embarrassing. They made humongous efforts to stop it, and of course they failed in the end. But the release of those files provided us with pretty much all the material. I mean, Lizzy wouldn't have started her blog and all the information unless it was based on the files. I mean, we had a field day for finding out all the inconsistencies and you know, all the lies that have been told by different people, all the evidence that was found. So I believe that from memory, they managed to suppress about 1% of the material for some reason or other. They made a big effort in the court, but they lost that one.
Yeah, they sometimes the newspapers actually did start to quote some of the things, particularly from Gonzalo Amaral's hearing in 2010, where Tavares de Almeida and some of the others actually got up and said in the court exactly what some of the police files had said. Now, it was released on the newspaper's headlines, but what I found out, what I noticed, was that Jerry McCann rushed out of court on, I think, the Thursday and said he had business to do in Britain and he had to get back and leave the court. And Fiona was going to take over from him with Kate the following day. But when I looked in the Maddie case files, they have a whole complete index of every newspaper during the course of this time and dates chronological. And when I looked, the following day, the actual headlines were just really about the dogs, everything. Mm-hmm. 3 days later, there was nothing.
Yeah.
What I believe is that Jerry McCann went back and they stopped everybody right there and then. They just have control over so much thing. You know, we haven't actually dealt with some of the press issues, but do you believe the same, that they weren't actually able to stop news reports?
Well, funnily enough, I've just been watching a video this morning, nothing to do with the Madeleine McCann case, but it explores the huge control that the media and big tech have at the moment in so many areas of life. And it's bigger than it was 13 years ago. But if I can just mention this point. Many, many years ago, when I was studying law, I got a hold of a book by Peter Carter Ruck, and it was a guide to libel law, a fairly straightforward legal book. But, you know, he is the architect of the extension of the libel laws in this country. And our friend Shirley from America will probably confirm for me that America has far more liberal laws of free speech than we have. And in many countries, I would have been allowed to publish the book, 60 Reasons, without any comeback at all. Because at the end of the day, the McCanns were making claims. They made a claim that Madeleine was abducted. And I would have thought that any citizen could question that. You know, it's not as if one is making an accusation. We're just saying, look, I'm not sure that you're telling the truth. And I think in America and in Germany and many other countries, you would be able to speak without being threatened immediately with a libel action. I didn't think really that they would push it as far as they did. I always had a thought in my mind that they wouldn't actually take me to court. It's probably rather foolish on my part.
Well, you certainly paid the price, and you paid the price literally, didn't you, Tony? In fact, you're still paying the price.
Well, for those who don't know, and just to go over the facts again, the court bill I was given in the end that I settled on was to pay them $27,500. And I paid back $23,000, I think. I've just got another $3,000 to pay over the next 3 years. And then I'm done.
Well, I mean, this is just incredible. There's hundreds, thousands of us in the Maddie community, but you are the one that is paying, and it's just outrageous that they would do that to you.
Let me just say this: when you say, you know, I'm paying, I've been able to cope with that. It sounds like a lot of money, but I've been able to manage that, paying it out gradually over the 7 years since then. But if anyone has paid the price, without a doubt, it is Gonçalo Amaral, because I don't know how much the McCanns ever paid him for the court costs, which they should have done. I really don't know. But he has been brought down from a very great height, and he was a very great man, a great investigator. And they really did ruin his life in a way that they failed to ruin mine. So I would extend all my sympathy to Gonçalo Amaral, and I consider I'm very fortunate to be where I am today.
Well, certainly in comparison to Gonçalo Amaral, there is a difference. I mean, for you, it's tough. But yeah, I mean, to think what they did to Gonçalo Amaral, it's just amazing that he's still around, that he still has an interest in the case. He was on Mark Salnoconoco's podcast last year, which was or the year before, actually, I think now. And that's he's just an amazing man, and he has been. It was just disgusting. We did have a live dealing with some of the things that Gonçalo Amaral has gone through, having to been asked to divorce, basically, so that they could secure their money if they won. They actually lost. Has he got any money from them yet? Do you know, Tony?
I really don't know. I honestly don't know at all.
Yeah, there was some question. He won, but they were holding back. They were trying to fight it, weren't they?
I never read of any settlement that was publicized in the press. We know that the court order, I think, was made for the McCanns to pay him about £400,000 or something. It was a large amount of money.
Yeah, something like that.
Gonçalo Amaral would have a problem he'd have to sue, I guess, in the English courts, would he not? Probably. The McCanns being in England. And it could be, I'm only guessing, it could be that the poor man didn't feel able to summon up the energy and the legal costs that would be necessary to bring an action in the United Kingdom. That is my take on it. I may be wrong. Yeah.
I wasn't
far out, was I? £400,000. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Tony, you were $6 out.
I was just going to tell you, Lizzy, I didn't know if you wanted, they're starting to put questions up. Did you want me to put those up now? Because every time I do, it covers up Tony's face. So I don't want to put them up till you're ready for them.
Let's go. Yeah.
Love the questions.
Okay. So there's the first one.
Well, I think that's quite an easy one. Because I know a little bit about the European Court of Human Rights because I helped to bring a case there back in 1987 on a different matter concerning children in care and adoption. Yes, the McCanns have filed. There's a four-stage process in the European Court of Human Rights. You have to bring your case within 6 months. They have to check that it's admissible. And there are certain other procedural things, which I know they've got over that. And then the next stage is to see if the case has merit. And I don't think actually we've got to this stage yet, because you've got to go through those first two stages of proving your case is admissible and proving that it's got merit before you actually get to the court itself. And I'm not sure if the case has actually been passed from the committee to the court. So yes, of course, I mean, in answer to the question, yes, the McCanns have filed in the European Court of Human Rights, and I dare say the European Court of Human Rights will get around to hearing the case. But if I just make this point, it's that the European Court can't do anything except give an opinion. They may give a very strong opinion that Gonçalo Amaral's rights have been the McCann's rights have been interfered with, and that the Portuguese government treated them badly and unfairly, because the McCann's bring their case against the government, not against the McCann's, the Portuguese government. And the best outcome that the McCann's can hope for is that the European Court gives them some money as compensation. So if they win, as it were, the European Court would say, yes, the poor McCanns have been violated. Their rights have been violated by the Portuguese government, not by Gonçalo Amaral, but by the Portuguese government. And then the court has the power to make an award. And it's usually not very much money. It's usually something like £20,000 or £50,000. So whether it's worth the McCanns doing that, I don't know. But that's the best outcome that they can come up with. I guess the reason they're doing it is to prove that they were right, to prove that they were dealt with harshly and so on. But I don't know if that answers the question.
Is the money for Gonçalo Amaral held until that's decided?
I've got a question. Do I answer this? How does the statute of limitation?
Is Tony frozen?
I think so.
Okay.
So we'll wait to see if he catches up or gets kicked out, and we'll have to come back.
Yeah, he did mention that that was a possibility. So
yeah,
but he's got. If there's anybody that's got the information, it's Tony. The work he has done, the things he has done, has really helped the case tremendously, and now he's in the process of contacting, as he was saying, the Portuguese police and journalists with translations to make it easier. I'm sure also that Gonçalo Amaral would be happy about that, to see some of the translations, because so many are supportive of him. And he wouldn't have been able to view those because he doesn't speak English.
Right.
But, I mean, there is an amazing amount of work done. I can't see it right now. But apparently there's a letter that's been translated that's going over to Portugal. And there's some amazing information on it. I hope Tony comes back soon, because I'm not familiar with all the information involved in that letter. I think it's fairly recent, and I haven't been around a lot lately. But just some of the incredible things that he has done. In the meantime, while we wait for him, I'm going to play one of the videos that Tony asked me to play, and give you a little bit more insight into what Tony is about. So just give me one moment here. Okay.
Lizzy, can you make it large screen? Can you expand it?
Is it large screen now?
Yes, it is now. Okay.
Yeah, it takes a while.
Okay.
Grief, hope, desperation. Suggestions.
Just to confirm, they're not seeking any support from the Fine Madeleine Fund for legal costs, which some people have been asking about.
And I mean, concerning this fund, could they actually use it for themselves if they wanted?
Well, technically they could, as the fund is run by a limited company. It's not a charity.
Even if you send a check or anything in an envelope to Kate and Jerry in Rosely, it'll get there. Everything. People from around the world are doing that, as we're. In your soul, you hear a voice.
Did you kill your daughter?
No. How could we have disposed of her in the body, you know, when it was an immediate threat? It's just nonsense, so.
Well, that gets even more ludicrous, that we've obviously hidden her somewhere incredibly well, where nobody's found her.
Incredibly
well. So well that we then decided we'd move her in the car, which we hired weeks later.
Forensic discovery. Sky sources learned that a full DNA match to Madeleine McCann was found in the car hired by her parents after her disappearance.
That perhaps they're talking about body fluid from a decomposing body, and that might just explain why police here seem quite confident that Madeleine is now dead. It's the moral truth, we're giving it all. Anybody who knows the facts and who's actually familiar with the actual evidence who could hold that opinion.
The McCanns family and friends in the UK told reporters that the shutters were variously broken, jimmied open, or smashed. In fact, the shutters were not in any way damaged.
Parents of Madeleine McCann are now considered formal suspects by the Portuguese police authority in the disappearance, perhaps even death, of their own daughter.
Kate and Jerry McCann, they have both been today declared winners,
suspected of killing his daughter and disposing of her body. Earlier in the day, they'd watched as Kate McCann left after her second day of intense questioning. At the beginning of the five-hour interview, she was told she was being designated a suspect.
You just, you're into each other, do you know what I mean? You kind of
can't do this anymore, just want to press a button and we're all gone and it's all finished and we're all together.
Now, before we get to any questions, is there anything you wanted to say, Tony, about that video? And welcome back. Are you there?
It looked like he got dropped again, so we'll have to wait a second for him to come back.
Oh, okay. And for some reason, I have that situation where the, another video plays without me realizing it. But yeah, I saw he was here for a little while. And then
he was. And then he got dropped. So that's okay. It's the internet.
Yeah. That's what happens to us all, right? Sometimes. Yeah. A couple of issues on that. Keeping in mind, these videos that I made are from almost 10 years ago. So there has been some very, very slight updates on them, which I haven't been able to do because you can't really do it on YouTube. So the 15 out of 19 markers was found. That is not exactly the case. 15 of 19 of Madeleine's markers were found in 32, I believe. So I just want to, just to be factual, I just wanted to make that clear that it wasn't, there wasn't 19 markers found and 15 of them were Madeleine's. There was, I think it was 32 markers found and 15 of Madeleine's 19 were found. So I just wanted to make that clear. But one interesting point, which I referred to last week, was if you noticed the video clip of the Australian Channel 9 news asking him if he killed his daughter, where he replies that he almost went to say disposed of the body. And that's where one of the body language experts really, at that point, I think that was his light bulb moment. But I see Tony's back. Welcome back, Tony. Sorry you're having this trouble.
Yeah, sorry about that, yeah. I think I was just answering the question about the period of what was it called? The time in which you can apply and be out of time in the applications. Yeah, the statute of limitations. Thank you very much. So shall I answer that?
Of course.
Yeah. The position is that before you can go to the European Court of Human Rights, you must exhaust all remedies in your own country. So the McCanns, as you know, brought an action in 2010 or 2009, and then there was court hearings in 2010, two court hearings in 2010, another one in 2011, another one in 2013, another one in 2014. And that might have been the last one. There might have been another one, I think, after that, 2015. But they have to do everything possible in Portugal to get a remedy. And of course, in the end, they failed because the court decided in favour of Gonçalo Amaral, which was excellent. They considered that their rights had been violated under the European Convention of Human Rights, the right to their reputation and so on. And so at that point, if they'd gone as far as they could in the legal system in the Portuguese government, they then had 6 months in which to apply to the European Court of Human Rights. And I know from my knowledge of what happened before that they did apply in time. And so somewhere their case is snagged up in the European Court.
Oh, so it's still ongoing?
Yes, ongoing, yeah.
Yeah. Was there anything in the video that you wanted to speak to?
Or
did you not manage to see it while you were gone?
I did actually. No, I had to come in twice actually. It's a bad internet connection here, and I do apologise to everybody and hope we can keep going. I just thank you for the excellent video, which really addressed the plight I was in at the time. I was very grateful for your support at the time. It was a very low moment, I can tell you. All, you know, everything seemed to cave in at that time. But anyway, you know, thanks to a very good wife and a lot of friends and support, I survived, and here I am today, Liz.
Yeah, that's just wonderful. You're still fighting away. There was one point, and I just have the video, which I haven't played, not necessarily need to play, but if you want me to, it's where Midlands Today, I think, interviewed you outside the court, and you'd claimed that you were giving up on it for now.
Well, that was absolutely how I felt at the time. I thought, well, I've done my bit for the cause, as it were. There's all these hundreds of other people out there, ferreting away, trying to look at the case and do something, but people said to me, look, Tony, you've done enough now. You've done your bit. Give it a rest. And many people told me to give it a rest. And actually, I can't lose interest, because something gets into you. When you see an injustice, you have to do something about it. Same as the poor man, Stuart Lubbock, who was killed. I mean, he lived in my hometown in Harlow. That's why I took it up. And, I wanted to see justice done. It was the same in this case. And once you get the feeling that an injustice has been done, you want to keep on with it. So I haven't lost my interest, but I have to be very, very careful what I say, because I'm still bound by a court order. I can't make accusations against the McCanns. I have to be very careful. I can talk about the evidence. I can make comments about the evidence, but I can't make any accusation. Otherwise, they might drag me back to court.
So, Tony, I'm sorry for interrupting, but one of the questions was, what's your opinion of what happened to Madeleine? Is that something that you can't discuss?
What do the lawyers say in court, or the witnesses? What they say is, I refer to my previous answers.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, that's such a difficult. And you know, I've got a few little screenshots of some of your efforts that you've gone to. This was when you went to number 10.
We did. I believe that is a petition that we organised. It was a petition, I think, on the Prime Minister's website, Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. We had the ability, and we still have, to launch a petition, an online petition, and to be frank, we didn't get many signatures. We got some thousands of signatures, but it's a minority interest, and we didn't reach that many people, although our petition was online, I think, for 6 months at the time. But anyway, it doesn't matter. We got a few thousand. So we went to Downing Street and let people know that we were active, and so people, I think by that time Jill had set up a forum, Complete Mystery of Madeleine McCann. So yeah, there's a lot of publicity going on there at the time, and it was to try and keep momentum up, keep publicity of, show that we were active. And you just put that one up on the Oxford Union. You know what that was, Lizzie? Why we went to no.
I can't say I do.
What happened there was Clarence Mitchell was invited to speak at the Oxford Union. Oxford University, which is Britain's one of Britain's oldest and finest universities. And to speak at the Oxford Union means that you're in the big time. If somebody asks you to speak at the Oxford Union, then you've really made it. And so we lobbied this... a couple of us there outside. We printed a 6-page leaflet called, I think from memory, it was called Clarence Mitchell Master Manipulator, Master Media Manipulator, and we handed it out in the street. We actually went, me and the other lady there, we went into all the colleges and put the material up on college notice boards, and then we lobbied outside the meeting. And handed the leaflet in to people as they were going to hear Clarence Mitchell. And I did.
How great.
I did actually try to get in the meeting. I remember quite clearly, I walked up the stairs to the meeting, and just as I was about to enter the room, a hand swiftly came down from the doorkeeper there, just to block my way. And he said, "You can't come in." I said, "Why is that?" He said, "We've seen you outside." So that was the end of that. I couldn't hear Clarence Mitchell speak.
I think I have the video of it, or at least a portion of it. And you also hear outside the Ministry of Justice.
Yeah, we thought we could make an impact. Don't tell me you're not hearing me now. Yeah.
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, right.
So, yeah, you thought you could make an event, but are you saying that there wasn't a lot of interest in it?
What this event here, you mean, the Ministry of Justice?
Yeah. Oh, well, you thought you could make the event with Clarence. I'm sorry.
Yeah, with Clarence. Yeah. I've seen another question come up. Let me try and answer that then while it's up, before we lose connection. When the police close the case, can all the police files be asked for by Freedom of Information No, they can't. Not at all. It's a rule in this country that all the files on a police case are permanently unavailable to the public by freedom of information. You cannot get them, which is what made this case so unusual. There were two reasons why the Madeleine McCann case was, it has been such a cause célèbre for us, because without the Portuguese files, Liz, we wouldn't be here today, I don't think. There'd be nothing for us to go on, or very little, shall we say. We probably still would be here, but that the release of those files was pretty much unprecedented. It doesn't happen in most countries. It's very, very rare. And they, as you know, the McCanns were so shocked they had to go to court and try and suppress them from coming out. But no, short answer to that question, we will never see those files.
Yeah, I remember at the same time is when Gonzalo Amaral released his book. I think, was it the month before or the month after he released his book? And that's when the McCanns started claiming to go to court because of the what they'd caused them, the grief they'd caused.
Yes.
He'd caused them. They were using every way forward to try and...
The interesting thing is, I believe they waited about 11 months before... yes, it was 11 months, I believe, before they actually took action. If you remember, Gonçalo Amaral's book came out roughly the same time as the Attorney General's verdict in July 2008. And... the McCanns didn't bring their action in the Lisbon court until 11 months later, I think June or possibly late May 2009. There was quite a gap before they acted. Incidentally, Liz, if I can just mention, it is on the screen that I sent you earlier, but one of the things we've done in the last few years is we got hold of the English gag, the Gonçalo Amaral book in Portuguese, and we paid for a translation of the chapter.
I'm just trying to find the.
I've got the note here actually. It was. What was the chapter?
Okay. Yeah, I see the one it is.
What was the chapter called now? It was called Terrible News. That's right. Yes, Terrible News. So we got hold of the book. Chapter 6, Terrible News. We got it translated and it's up on Jill's forum on Complete Mystery of Madeleine McCann. And it's a terrible story. I don't want to kind of spoil the fun, as it were, but it tells you how he learnt about the fact that there was an injunction on him. I won't spoil it for people who don't know the story. Read the story and see how he found out. It's quite shocking, really, quite shocking.
And while you're discussing that, Tony, if I can just say that the Complete Mystery of Madeleine McCann with Jill Haven is one of, or if not the greatest Madeleine McCann forum that you could visit. And I do encourage you to join there and visit. It's... maybe one of the mods can put up. Oh, yes, Claire's there. She's put up the link to Jill's forum. It's an absolute, you have no idea how much information is in there. All of Tony's information is there, right, Tony?
I was just going to cut in and say that people complain about the forum because they say there's too much on it. People say, oh, you know, it's just so difficult to cope with that forum because there's so much on it. But, it's all there if you want to have a look. There's so much on there. You're quite right. Yes, you're quite right.
Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, I'm not sure the actual date. Well, you mentioned that Jill started it when you were...
I didn't know Jill before 2009. I didn't really. But she made contact with me round about... the time before I was taken to court to begin with, when I made the I was forced to make these undertakings, and she contacted me and she said, look, Tony, I want to help. And you know, I I think there were some other things going on as well at the time. And she said, look, I'm right with you. We want to help. And she started the forum, as it happens, by coincidence, on the same day that I was in court giving these wretched undertakings. And quite funny, really, because I can't remember what the forum was called to begin with, but the name of the forum changed very soon afterwards. This was November 2009. And about 3 months later, as a result of the court case in early 2010, after one of the court cases, Clarence Mitchell faced a very good interviewer, actually, one of the best I've ever seen, who tackled him with some real good questions. And during this interview, he said, it's a complete mystery. The case is a complete mystery. So Jill immediately seized on that and said, I know what I'm going to call my forum. Let's call it The Complete Mystery of Madeleine McCann. The name of the name of the forum comes from Clarence Mitchell.
Oh, that's good. But it really is. I mean, Jill looks after it. Verity looks after it. And they do a great job. I mean, there is a lot of information there, but it is separated if you want to take time. And you can always ask if you need to find a specific topic. There's always somebody around. Also on Heidi Ho Controversy, if you join in there and ask us, we'll give you the link to the Complete Mystery Forum. Or there is also a Complete Mystery of Madeleine McCann Facebook group. So you can search. And honestly, you won't find any greater information than on Jill's forum. It's absolutely great. I do want to make mention of the Maddie case files too, because they are the ones who the admin actually translated the files. And I think it's important to remember them for what the huge amount of work they did putting into the translations with about 4 years of work, I think. I asked Inez about 4 years later, and she was still translating. So check out Maddie case files as well. But they're two different kinds of forums. So, yeah, I'm so happy. That's where we met, wasn't it, Tony? But anyway, carry on with the, if he's still there.
I don't know. He might have froze again.
Yeah. Yeah, I highly recommend both of those forums. And Tony has put pretty much all his research in there. And there's so many different areas to go to, but you will find exactly what you need. And as he was saying, there was something else on the message he sent me, which quite shocked me. I'm not sure which of the pages it was on. It was something I don't know about because it's just been fairly recent.
I'm going to move this question off the screen. I'll wait till he comes back.
Yeah, because he did actually do something with that, and I'd rather him answer that.
Yep.
Now I'm just looking here. I think it was to do with the detectives wrote a book, and what they discovered.
Wait, the detectives? Which detectives?
The McCanns private detectives.
Okay.
And they were something else. It was unbelievable. If I just go through here. It was something to do with their book, and I've obviously gone straight past it. Ah, here we go. Now, the Complete Mystery of Madeleine McCann has a group, Madeleine McCann Research Group. They paid for a professional interpreter to translate into English a key chapter of the book La Cortina da Humo, The Smokescreen, by the former Metodo 3 private detectives. Now, this chapter apparently revealed the corrupt inner workings of Metodo 3, and the article is titled Exclusive to CMOMM, Corruption and Criminality Inside the Metodo 3 Investigation, extracts from a book by two Metodo 3 men. It can be read on Jill's forum. And Tony, I believe, is back with us.
I am indeed. Sorry about that again. Perhaps I can answer the question that was put up, Liz, come either one that was put up just now, which was, could the McCanns, is there a civilian case against the McCanns for neglect? Okay, let me start from this point. First of all, the offence occurred in Portugal, if it was an offence of neglect. So if it was an offence of leaving the children on their own, it would certainly come under neglect. And the case would normally be brought in Portugal, but no case was brought, as you know, obviously because the Portuguese police soon had different ideas about what had really happened. I'm not sure if you remember this, Liz, but the thing that made me known at the beginning was that I actually brought a private prosecution against the McCanns for neglect, which is the right of anybody in the country to bring a private prosecution if they think somebody has committed a crime. It's not a very often used right, but I wrote to the court in Leicestershire and submitted the evidence that Madeleine had been left on her own 5 nights in the week, which actually was an admission that Kate McCann had made publicly in the Mirror and the Independent in August of 2007. So I thought I was on pretty safe ground. They'd actually admitted to leaving the children on their own. It was very swiftly turned down because the High Court said that the Leicestershire Magistrates Court didn't have jurisdiction. In other words, they weren't sure that the case could be heard in England. I had researched this very carefully beforehand, and in actual fact, under another European convention, if you are the parent of a child who's neglected their child abroad, you can be made the subject of a private prosecution in your own country, in England in this case. It's part of a European-wide agreement that applies across all European countries. But anyway, the court declined it, saying that they didn't have jurisdiction. But I believe they did have jurisdiction. I believe that they could have been prosecuted. I know that Leicestershire Magistrates Court sent my letter up to the government pretty quickly. I got an answer very swiftly, and it was from London. So they obviously high powers involved saying, no, there's no way we're going to allow this case to run in Leicestershire or anywhere else.
There was one thing I did, which I seem to recall, is by Portuguese law, there is the neglect, but it has to be proven with intent in Portuguese law. And that may be an issue as well, because they actually cannot probably be proven to be intentional in leaving her alone to put her at risk. But anyway, so is there another question, Shirley?
Sorry, I had it on mute. I'm scrolling. I thought I had another one. Let me see.
Yeah, it's hard to tell. I can see the chat out the corner of my eye, but I can you see any of the chat, Tony?
Where am I looking? I can see.
We'll take that as a no.
I can see Lizzie. I can see Shirley. There is something called private chat here or comments on the right. Is it chat
with other guys? At the very top.
At her comments, go to comments on that list, and that's the chat.
Loads. Do you want me to go through these?
Well, that's what I'm going through right now. Okay, that's where
all right.
Yeah, so I was just mentioning, Tony, one of the points that you brought up, which there was actually another point which I must remember to ask you, but the one about the Matodo 3 and the translation of their book really shows criminal intent. How crazy is that?
I don't know how many people know about this book, actually. This book was, it's called La Cortina de Homo, which is translated in English as The Smokescreen. And it was written by Julian Peribonez, who is one of the Matodo 3 investigators, and somebody we've not heard of called Antonio Tamarit. And I would recommend reading this. Well, the whole book is interesting, but we got translated the main chapter that deals with the Madeleine McCann case, of course. The book deals a bit wider with Matodo 3's activities, but this chapter is just about Madeleine McCann. It's very well worth a read. What it shows in a nutshell is that the investigation was a complete sham. And if you, the article, I've given the link, the article's on our forum, it's well worth a read. It's a complete and utter sham. And Julian Peribonez, of course, fell out with the boss of Matodo 3, Francisco Marco. And there is one very funny bit in it concerning the one of the Matodo 3 investigators met with the Portuguese police, I think, and there was a discussion. No, with the English police, I think. Yeah, with the English police, that's right, with English. And there was a to and fro about the laws in the different countries. And Matodo 3 was being criticised, and the Matodo 3 lady investigator hit back with a comment about child sexual abuse in the United Kingdom, which is a very valid point. It was that she was making the point, look, you know, before you criticize us here and Matodo 3 and the Portuguese police, then just have a look at the scale of sexual abuse going on in your own country.
So that's let me see. Yeah. So somebody went for a question.
I've got this question here. Well, all I will say there, I've got to be careful here, but all I will say is that if you look at the interim report of Tavares de Almeida, which was on the 10th of September 2007, it was published 3 days after the McCanns were charged, as it were, or made official suspects, I should say. But the conclusion of the interim report by Tavares de Almeida was that the furniture had been rearranged. I'm not sure they went into detail about the evidence for that, but there was evidence that somehow the scene had been set to create the impression of an abduction. As to why the McCanns lied, I can't answer that.
Yeah, it's so difficult for you, and I absolutely appreciate you coming on here. So please understand, and everybody, that this is important for Tony not to answer some questions.
Okay, this one then I've got on the screen. Is this Christian Bruckner suspect case a strategy to try and influence the ECHR? I'll be honest with you, Liz. We mentioned this on the phone the other day, but I've not taken any interest in Christian Bruckner because the way I see it is it's just one more fake abductor that the Metropolitan Police and Operation Grange want to pin the blame on for the abduction. And you know, I knew it was fake from the beginning, and I'm sorry to say I've taken no interest in it. I can't understand. This has been going on for about 18 months, hasn't it? Bruckner here, Bruckner there, it's just another fake abductor. It's just I take the same view as Wendy Murphy did, if you remember, when the BBC program went out and they put the eFits up, and she did a wonderful 3-minute interview on television in the United States somewhere. Shirley will know when it was put out. And she just said, look, I'm not going down this rabbit hole. It's another fake abductor. I'm not interested. Brilliant.
I do actually have that video on here somewhere, but I can't find it. But
I think it's a hoot because the interview is just left completely floundering by Wendy Murphy. It was brilliant.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely great. The
There's a question here from Sandy Blue. Can you explain how the statute of limitations applies in Portugal? I'm going to have to pass on the one, Sandy Blue, I'm afraid, because I don't know the law in Portugal on that. I'm awfully sorry. I can't help you on that one.
This next one isn't a question, but I'm going to put it up there. Well, it is a question, but I'm going to put it up there anyways.
I've got that covered. I would say to you, I would say to anybody who feels generous about that, it's really a lovely offer. I can deal with this. And if you've got money to spare, give it to your favorite good cause, please. There are many, many good causes, and give it to one of those. But it's a lovely question. Thank you very much.
Yeah, there's so many lovely, generous people. And Tony, that is so great that you would say that. I know that you've initially it was a real challenge for you, but you have refused help before, haven't you?
Well, I have. However, I will say this, that and I ought to issue a thank you right now, that one of our very good friends in the what was the Madeleine Foundation did set up a fund for me, and some very kind people did make donations, and I think let's get the amount correct. I believe that they raised something like £2,000 to £2,500, and it was at a time when I wasn't quite sure how things were going to go, and it was very much valued, and I thank heartily any those who made the contributions, and it kind of gave me a lift. It was nothing like 27,500, but I really appreciated it, and so I'm just going to say thank you to all those, maybe some of them listening, who did throw in their £5 or £10. I did appreciate it, and I did accept that.
Yeah, everybody I think wanted to help, the same as they did with Gonçalo Amaral, and got together the £52,000 for his appeal. And when you stop and think about it, the actual appeal was worth it because he won. Now, would that have happened? Was this the McCanns, do you think, trying to catch him out because they'd taken all his money? They didn't realize that we were gonna get together and get the money together, and ultimately he won. So I think that was probably what they were thinking. He wasn't going to be able to afford an appeal.
Liz, I'm just going to jump in here and mate, because I'm just amazed at how you can, within a split second, get some document or photograph up. I think it's just phenomenal. I don't know how you do it. It's brilliant.
She's a wizard. She's a wizard.
It's not as brilliant as you're thinking, but thank you anyway.
To get back to the point, I can't remember now. I thought perhaps the McCanns thought that that Gonçalo Amaral was getting all this help, and so he wouldn't need to get into debt over the legal funds. But of course he must have done. He must have. I mean, that's the figure was there you put up on the screen was 50,000. The costs must have been much, much more than that for his lawyers. Much more. I mean, how many hearings did he have to go through? 6, I think, possibly 7. He would have to pay his lawyers. They wouldn't do it for free.
Yeah, I can't remember. And I, as you were saying, can't imagine what he went through. But let's not detract that and minimise what you went through. And okay.
There's a nice question here from Paul, if I can answer it.
Okay.
I don't know. Oh, sorry, it's not from Paul. It's from Emily Cheatham, and she's calling me Paul, I think. But anyway, the question is, if the McCanns admit after the time, what happens? If they admit, well, for a start, I'll get my money back. That's the first thing that will happen.
The most important thing to you, yeah.
Yeah. But it's not going to happen, is it? It's not going to happen. But if there was an admission, they would be brought to court, of course, and they would. That's a good question as to who would, if there ever was an admission, and these things are not impossible, where the action would be brought. I presume it would have to be brought in Portugal, you say. And so there would have to be some kind of legal proceeding in Portugal where an admission is made of whatever. And then, whoever makes the admission would be punished. The implications would just be phenomenal. It would be, it's a good question, but it's unthinkable, isn't it, that it would ever happen?
Well, it is really. And would an admission lead to a trial, or would they just be classified as claiming?
There'd be a trial. I mean, even if somebody admits an offence, there has to be a trial in order for judgment to be applied, of course, a sentence.
Yeah. And I often refer to the I can't remember what it is, but just on, I think, the May the 17th, I think many of them went into, as far as I know, as reported, went into court to save their statements.
Mm-hmm.
And that's saved until and unless it's not opened. It was sealed. And unless there's a trial, they won't be public. But if there's a trial, they would be brought out in it. And that would be interesting to see. Mm-hmm. Well, just a trial would be interesting. Mm-hmm. Goodness.
Mm-hmm. Liz, there's a question here I'd like to answer from somebody called Spazwagon. The question is, Tony, what is your opinion on Operation Grange? I've used these two words ever since the beginning in 2011. It's an expensive charade. So I've used these two words. The whole thing is an expensive charade. It's fake. The whole thing is fake. It's just designed to continue the narrative.
And I absolutely agree with you.
I think my opinion is exactly the same as Wendy Murphy. But right from day one, I knew it myself. I wasn't very popular on the forum for a time because people said, look, Tony, do you really think that they would set up an operation like this and it's fake? You know, they're genuinely trying. And people for years kept on thinking that this was a genuine investigation. And as I say, I took a lot of flack from people who said, look, how can you be so cynical? But I think now in 2021, when we're approaching the 10th anniversary of Operation Grange, I hope most people might agree with me.
Yeah, it's who knows what's going to happen. Do you have a thought as to why Operation Grange continue currently? Because there is no way, as far as I'm concerned, no way that they could justify it as to a search, or whether these German issues. And by the way, if anybody wants to know about why the Christian Bruckner investigation or whatever you call it is absolutely fake, just watch Mark Salnokonoko's new podcast. He's released one episode and it's called They've Taken Her. And that will tell you exactly why it's just fake. So yeah, do you have any conclusions as to why Operation Grange is still in effect?
No, even though
there's no way on this earth they could search and justify searching.
I'm surprised that it is, Liz. It's a puzzle to me, because I would have thought that they could have closed this years ago. I think they've always wanted to find a fake suspect, and we know that when they showed the BBC
Is Tony disappearing on us again? We give him a couple of minutes, or usually once he freezes, he goes away, right? Yeah, my thoughts on Operation Grange, which likely disagree with maybe what Tony feels, because I spoke to some of the detectives in Operation Grange initially. I, at that time, was convinced that it was for real, the way they were coming to me to ask for information about the McCanns. They wanted to see my videos, and they assured me that everything was looked at. Now, that was back in, I think, 2013, I'm not sure. But possibly the higher echelons have taken over and changed it. Now, I do know that Colin Sutton was invited, or heard that he was going to be invited to join Operation Grange, and he decided not to do it because there was a limitation on what he was going to be investigating, and it meant that the McCanns could not be investigated in this case. So who knows? This was before Operation Grange actually started. So I really don't know. I still stay with the fact, or what, sorry, not the fact, stay with the possibility, the positive side, that Operation Grange is there and justifies getting the money every month, every year, because they have to wait until Portuguese police release their information, because it's not under the jurisdiction of Operation Grange to make. I think they can be in charge of the fund. If there's an investigation into the fund, they have the jurisdiction. But as far as the actual investigation goes, I believe it's got to be via the PJ. And from what we understand, and hopefully one very soon, I'm going to get I've asked Isabel McFadden. She's very much knowledgeable on a lot of the Portuguese police details, and they seem to know what really happened, as we know from the Portuguese files. So maybe I just wish that Operation Grange was there for that reason. Tony's back. And another question for you, Tony.
Liz, I think what I'm going to do is the next time I get cut off, it seems to be about every 20 minutes. I'm going to knock it on the head then. So I'll keep going, but next time I get cut off, I'll end it there, I think.
Okay, well, thanks. In case you get cut off before, thanks so much for being with us, Tony. I really appreciate it, and I'm sure everybody else does, because the information that you have is just amazing. So anyway, carry on. Hopefully you won't go.
I'm so glad there's so many people still interested in this case and following. It's wonderful. So, Tony, why do you think the media won't touch this with a barge pole? Now, I've thought about this, and I think my eyes have been open.
Oh, no.
That was a quick one.
Don't say he's going.
Yeah, he's going. Dang it.
Well, I'm sure he'll come. Are you back, Tony? No, that was just you, right?
That was just me.
Took the question down. Well, I'm sure, and I hope, Tony, that you'll come back again. And now you have an idea of what the lives are about. And we've just been doing this for a few months, so we're starting to get a footing. And it's really been great to have Tony here. I'm sure everybody agrees. So let's see, was there any other questions that I know what we will do is, there's another, he was mentioning about how difficult it was at the time when he was going to court. And I think, and I hope, that this is the video that I did the night before he went into court. I was in tears the whole night. Just goodness knows how Tony felt. So I'm going to hope this time I've got the right video. Let me see. and it takes a little time for it to respond. So that's why we don't always get a an immediate full screen. Yeah, this was just before, the night before. Well, looks like I might be having problems too. We'll keep trying. I think I can see what happened there. It's just if it gets slow, it takes a while to respond. And I want to make sure I get the right one, because it's so emotional to know that the night after I did this video that he was appearing in court. Oh,
Lizzy, Tony's there.
Yeah.
Hold your video. Hold your video. Tony's back.
Okay. Video held.
Hi, Tony.
Hi there. Okay, you can hear me, but I'm really sorry. Anyway, I think the last question was about the media.
Yes.
And why the media wouldn't touch this. And I do have an answer for that. There are, let me put it this way. Most of the media are controlled by very powerful interests, very powerful people. And I've watched over the American election, and I've watched over other issues like Brexit, how the news media can shape stories any way they want to. They can promote certain things and they can completely nullify other stories. And for whatever reason, the media have decided internationally to, the mainstream media that is, to not to report on this case. And there's an additional reason, of course, and that is because the media, even if the owner of any television station wanted to cover this, they would be petrified of a libel action, which would cost them millions of pounds. So those two reasons together, I think, is why the media will never touch this story. And that's why people like Mark Sanakanoku are left to cover it. It's never on the mainstream media, but thank goodness we have one or two broadcasters here who are willing to have a look at it.
Yeah, and Mark's so good. Mark has, he has really researched. Before he put the podcast out, it took 2 years for him to research it. He was living it night and day from what I could make out, because I was getting messages goodness knows when. He's in Australia, so we didn't have the same time frame, but he did such a great job. I'm always best. I think you'd probably agree, wouldn't you?
Mm-hmm.
Tony, as far as podcasts go. So was there another question?
I'm just looking at the questions. Is Shirley still there to pop up another one?
I am. I'm looking through.
There's a lot of comments, so not all of them are questions, of course.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, we'd love to get the questions while we've got Tony here.
Yeah, hurry up.
I see one question. Well, it's a comment from somebody called Helen Happy Thoughts, who says, I think most people in the UK do think they're lying. Now, I'm not sure if that's correct, actually. We know that a lot of people don't buy this story, but to say that most people in the UK, I've thought about this, and I talked to people, many people over the years, and
many people are rather hesitant when you say to them, well, I don't believe the story at all. People will say something like, well, I don't believe everything they said was correct, but they can't actually make the jump of, they can't get it into their heads that it's possible that they may have been telling the untruth from the start. So I'm not sure what the balance of opinion is, actually, but there's many people who still believe the abduction, without a doubt.
Yeah. They've been taught to because they haven't, they want to defend what they first believed. And because there's not a lot in the media, it's hard. And that's why we're here. Like I say, we want to get the information to the UK.
I would say, just going off at a slight tangent, and I won't go into it because we're not here about that subject, but I believe that the media manipulation about coronavirus has been very heavy indeed. And one of my concerns there is that we don't hear alternatives. We only get one message all the time. And that's very dangerous. But I didn't really want to go down that road, but just illustrates the power of the media to me that they, we've seen it on the big tech. They won't allow any story which in any way questions the drastic lockdowns that are going on.
I think it's probably best to keep away from the COVID issues. I know I was reading today that they have many things in place to stop people questioning.
The only point that here is another issue where the media has completely got.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
So, okay, devil's advocate. Why did the McCanns react the way they did when they were told about the dog's alerts? Well, it's a good question because that was one of the extraordinary things really in the case, because it's clear that they reacted with shock, and so shocked were they that they came out with these ridiculous stories that we all know about, the rotting meat and the dirty nappies and taking things to the dump and so on. I mean, it was quite revelatory, shall we say. It was quite informative that they reacted in that way.
Yeah. And of course, the other thing to keep in mind, it was the blood dogs that were alerting, mm-hmm. not DNA dogs as mm-hmm. such. That's why the police brought in blood dogs. Mm-hmm. So when they alerted, it was blood they were alerting to, not dirty nappies mm-hmm. or anything. So that's worth keeping in mind.
That's what back in August 2007 was. There were two things that made me take this case up. One was the revelations about the blood and the alerts, and their reaction to them. That was one. The other was the involvement of Clarence Mitchell, the chief spinner for the government, the director of the media monitoring unit. And I just reasoned at the time, why would this incident, horrible though it was, why did it need the top public relations manager for the government to come down to Portugal? What was it about this case that made it so vital that this top man on a huge salary should be personally allocated to this case? And he has been now for what, 13 years? I smelt a rat. And it made me get very interested in the involvement of the security services in this case. And if we go through the files and the history, we know that MI5 were involved. We know that the security services were involved. They had profilers from the various branches of the government. So, and of course, if we look at the private investigations, we had Henry Exton being involved, who was a former head of covert intelligence at the MI5. We know that Kevin Halligan had many contacts with the security services. So to my mind, this is a security services operation for whatever reason. And that was why I got involved. I thought there must be something up here, something fishy, if it needs Clarence Mitchell to sort this out.
Yeah, there was definitely. I wanted to do a live, or I plan on doing a live, regarding the press and the restrictions and the cover-up. And maybe if I can have a chat with you later, and we could put something together and you'd appear again to discuss some of that.
Well, if I can, yes. I've got a question on here. Tony, have you seen the James Bogart investigation in this case from Tom O'Brien? I have looked at them, and I'm afraid I don't rate them at all. I think he's way off beam, is my reaction to that.
I would tend to agree with you there.
There are some good things on the internet, but I don't think he's anywhere near the mark, I'm afraid.
Yeah, I've never been enamored with any of his videos that I've seen. But sometimes, as long as somebody doesn't put, as long as somebody stays with the facts, you know, you can look past it to allow people to make their decisions themselves, their opinions. I absolutely believe in everybody having their own opinion, but it has to be based on facts. If you're going to form an opinion on blind belief of somebody without checking out the facts, then that's really not a credible opinion. And I think that's why we do what we do, right, Tony? We want to make sure that what I know, I research everything to make sure it's a fact, and I know you do too. Everything you do is based on factual information that you put together. Now, the conclusions may or may not be with mine, yours and mine, they may not be, but there are conclusions from the facts. So it looks like Tony's disappeared again. And what do you think, Shirley? Do you think it's time that we should maybe wrap it up for the day?
Yeah, it's if Tony were able to stay here, it would be great. But yeah, it's been almost 2 hours. I think that's good. And I really do hope that he agrees to come back.
I hope so. I do hope. I was so pleased when he accepted the offer to come and be a guest. That's absolutely great. So I'm going to lead out with the video that I did the night before his trial. And it was very emotional time for all of us, for all of us. And again, thank you, Tony, so much for being here. Really appreciate it. Thanks to all the mods. I haven't got all their names listed in front of me.
But we know who we are.
Yeah. Can I just say thank you so much, mods? They were right there today, ready. And I really appreciate the help. And thank you so much to everybody who has joined us today. Names I haven't seen before. And that is absolutely great, because ultimately this is about getting the information out to the world, in fact. But yeah. Specifically in my case, I'm public, because they have been prevented by the McCanns from seeing a lot of the information that's in the police files. And I think this is, YouTube is one of the few ways that we can do it. That was my intention when I first started doing the videos back in 2011, and it still is today. So hopefully we can start, this channel died for a little bit, a lot of videos. In fact, my very last video, which I recommend know about the case in general, it's one of Tony's videos that I uploaded. It's an audio video, but I think it's 2 hours, and he was being interviewed by, is it Mickey and Willie, or anyway, and it gives a comprehensive look over the case, according to Tony. And that may be of interest for somebody who doesn't know a lot about the case. I believe somebody may have the actual link, which they'll put in chat, hopefully. If not, I'm going to try and put all the links on. Well, I can't put any more links on the description, because I've put some of Tony's summary there.
You can put them in the comments. You can put them in the comments of the video.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
or one of us can.
I think maybe Claire might have got it there. I'm not sure. Anyway, I do encourage you. And if you go to the channel, it's one of the latest videos. It was the last one I actually did on the case separate to the lives, I think. So you can find it there. Of course, always go to Gonzalo Amaral's documentary, which if you click on home for the channel, it's on there. And really want to let everybody see exactly why we're all here, why Tony has done what he's done, why he's gone through what he's gone through, and why we're here every week. So thanks to everybody. Thanks, Chris and Kim. And I think that's it for now. So I'll just lead out with the video that was the night before Tony went into court. So give me a few moments here just to get it. And is that all for you, Shirley?
Yeah, that is. Just want to say goodbye to everybody. And again, thank you, Tony. And we hope you come back. Look forward to it. And everybody have a good weekend.
Okay. Thanks, everyone. And of course, I forgot to put the audio on, so I have to do it again. We're never gonna try. There's a little box. It's so tiny down in the corner, and if I forget it, that's it. Yeah. We don't get audio. So keep fingers crossed. Bye bye, everyone. Hope to see you all next week.
In this proud land we grew up strong. We were wanted all along. I was taught to fight, taught to win. I never thought I could fail.
Don't give up, cause you have friends. Don't give up, you're not here to get. Don't give up, I know you can make it good.
Though I saw it all around, never thought that I could be afraid. Thought that we'd be lost to know. It's so strange the way things turn.
Don't give up, it's too hard. Don't give up, we don't need much of anything. Don't give up, cause somewhere there's a place where we belong. Rest your head, you worry too much. It's gonna be alright. When times get rough, can't fall back on us. Don't give up, please don't give up. Don't give up, cause you have friends. Don't give up, you're not the only one. Don't give up, no reason. Don't give up, cause I believe.